20-15.
So, two championship points for Arthur Ashe.
Arthur Ashe won three Grand Slam events during his remarkable tennis career, including his Wimbledon title in 1975. He also won the U.S. Open in 1968 and the Australian Open in 1970. He was the first black to win each of those events. Ashe is from Richmond, Virginia, and attended Maggie Walker High School, where he won his first major title in 1959, the VIA State Championship. VIA stands for Virginia Interscholastic Association, which was the governing body for the black high schools in Virginia during segregation. Hello, my name is Walt Green and I will be narrating this film. This is part 5A, which is a special edition since the VIA was a special organization that the president of the Atlantic Coast Club was a part. The VIA and its predecessor, VIAL, was formed because of two United States Supreme Court rulings. The first case originated from Louisiana's Plessy v. Ferguson, when the court in 1896 upheld the constitutionality of racial segregation laws, also called Jim Crow laws, for public facilities, as long as they were equal in quality, a doctrine better known as separate but equal. This also formed the legal basis of separate school systems, which brings us to the second ruling, which occurred in 1954 in the combined case of Brown versus Board of Education, when the court ruled that racially segregation of children in public schools was unconstitutional. The Supreme Court combined five similar school segregation cases into one. The cases were Kansas, Brown versus Board of Education of Topeka, the case for which this combined case is named. The other four cases were Washington, D.C.'s Bowling versus Sharp, Delaware's Gephardt versus Belton, South Carolina's Briggs versus Elliott, and Virginia's Davis versus Prince Edward County School Board. These pictures were presented in the Virginia case. While the facts in each case were different, the main complaint in each case was inferior black schools, which violated the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment. NAACP lawyer Thurgood Marshall was the lead attorney in this landmark ruling case, which later fueled the Civil Rights Movement. Marshall would later become the first black justice to serve on the United States Supreme Court. Brown versus Board of Education, which affected mostly the South, meant schools had to integrate their segregated public school systems. This was met with immediate resistance from the governors of the southern states. And like the headline says, pupils will not be mixed right away. And in some states like Virginia, it will be many years. It was during this period of segregation in Virginia that the VIA was formed and thrived. We will examine the VIA in four parts: background, formation, achievements, and merger. VIA background. Prior to the early 1950s, the extracurricular activities at the black high schools in Virginia were governed by each activity and presided by the state chairperson. Competitions were held at district and state levels. However, each activity was organized different, and there was not any correspondence between the activities. The athletic program was the most popular activity and named VIAL, short for Virginia Interscholastic Athletic League. VIAL was administered through Virginia State College for Negroes, today's Virginia State University, which hosted many state championships, including the first Virginia Black High School basketball tournament in 1928. Virginia State President John Gandy understood the importance of athletics and also the importance of bringing black people together from across the state of Virginia to share ideas. Again, this was 1928. Here are the actual programs from the 3rd and 5th annual tournaments held in 1930 and 1932, respectively. Back to the early 1950s, the high school principals felt that these activities were being underutilized. Therefore, at the 1952 annual meeting with all the activity coordinators, the principals proposed a plan to consolidate all activities under one unit, which would be governed by the high school principals through an executive secretary. The organization would be named VIA, short for Virginia Interscholastic Association. Portland High School Principal Charles Womble presented the plan on behalf of the principals. He gave the following three reasons for consolidation. First, to increase student participation in all activities. Second, to form an organization similar to other leagues throughout the country, including their white high school counterpart in Virginia, the Virginia High School League, or VHSL. And third, to strengthen the overall financial setup. And
this was huge because it meant that Virginia State University could request the General Assembly to appropriate a budget for the VIA the same way that the University of Virginia does for the VHSL.
The plan was received with mixed reactions in athletics because this meant that the principals, not the athletic directors and coaches, would now be in charge. And after some debate, Womble pointed out that they, the coaches and athletic directors, would remain intact as a group. A committee was formed to study the proposal along with writing the Constitution. The proposed plan was endorsed with a tentative start date of September 1953, which would later be changed. VIA formation.
On April 20th, 1954, at the annual meeting of the high school principals of the Virginia Teachers Association, the VIA was activated. These are the original minutes from the first meeting, and four people were instrumental. First was J.M. Brooks, the president of the Principals Association, who stated that the purpose of the meeting was to activate the VIA. Second was previously mentioned Charles Womble, who was selected to be the chairman of the Legislative Council. Third was Dr. Robert Daniel, the president of Virginia State College, the host institution who received the federal grant to administer the program, and they also provided staff through the Field Services Division. Virginia State served as the main location for state competition for athletics. And fourth was Charles Page, who would later be selected to be the executive secretary of the VIA.
Again, the primary objective of the VIA was to promote student participation in all activities.
For competitions, schools were organized by group based on their student enrollment, and each group was divided into 11 districts based on their location. There was no regional competition, and each team qualified for state competition through their district.
VIA achievements.
There were over 100 black high schools in Virginia, and all of them would become members of the VIA. Many of the high schools were named after black pioneers, including six named after scientist George Washington Carver, located in Chester, Rapidan, Salem, Fieldale, Newport News, and South Norfolk, today's Chesapeake. And five high schools were named after educator Booker T. Washington, located in Roanoke, Staunton, Rocky Mount, Suffolk, and Norfolk. Other schools included Peabody and Petersburg, Parker Gray and Alexandria, and Burley, located in Charlottesville. The city of Richmond had two black high schools with Armstrong and Maggie Walker.
The Tidewater area of Virginia had several black high schools, in addition to the previously mentioned Carvers in Chesapeake and Newport News, along with the Booker T's located in Norfolk and Suffolk. Other black high schools in the region were Brewton Heights in Williamsburg, Phoenix in Hampton, IC Norcom in Portsmouth, Prince's Anne County in what is today's Virginia Beach, along with Union Kempsville, Crestwood in South Norfolk, today's Chesapeake, East Suffolk and John F. Kennedy, both in Suffolk. Last but not least, Huntington High School in Newport News.
Huntington High School was the creme de la creme, and everybody, if they wanted to do anything at all, wanted to attend Huntington High School.
There were several outstanding teams and coaches in the VIA. However, no one won more than Huntington High School's football and track coach, Thad Madden. Madden's football teams won 7 football VIA state titles, and his track teams won an amazing 19 state titles. As Hall of Fame sports writer Cal Jacobs opined, Madden-produced products have compiled one of the finest team records in the world of scholastic sports. In 1970, Coach Thad Madden received a presidential citation from President Richard Nixon for his exceptional service to others in the finest American tradition. One of his athletes, Earl Faison, is arguably the best VIA overall athlete by excelling in three sports.
Fortunate enough to be All-State in basketball, All-State in football, and champion shot putter, discus.
Faison played professional football for the San Diego Chargers and was an All-Star. At the 1965 AFL All-Star Game in New Orleans, Faison was one of 21 black players who threatened to boycott the game because of racial discrimination.
21 African Americans who were supposed to participate in the AFL All-Star Game in New Orleans at that time because of maltreatment by certain elements of the city, the taxi cabs, the establishments wouldn't allow service to us. We banded together and decided that we would not play there. So the game was moved to Houston.
Faison would later become a high school educator in San Diego and coach NFL Hall of Famer Marcus Allen at Lincoln High School before becoming the school's principal. He credits his Newport News teachers for his inspiration.
I did go to school in Newport News, Virginia. Being in the South in that particular time, we had a pretty rough time. And I grew up on the, quote, other side of the track in a housing project and was fortunate enough to attend some very good schools. And I was lucky enough to have some people within those schools take an interest in me and made education very important to me.
One of Coach Madden's star track pupils was Ray Pollard, who holds the VIA 100 and 200-yard dash records, and he also anchored Huntington to back-to-back mile relay titles at the prestigious Penn Relays. In 1965, Pollard was selected as the Penn Relays' most outstanding athlete. Pollard has been a high school coach at Newport News for almost 50 years and still coaches today. Also, Pollard has helped coach our track club. Some other BIA notables include Super Bowl III champ Cornell Gordon from Booker T of Norfolk, Super Bowl IV champ and Hall of Famer Willie Lanier from Maggie Walker, and Super Bowl V champ Charlie Stoops from Crestwood. Also, two-time NBA champ Bob Dandridge from Maggie Walker, and World Series champ Al Bunbury is from Ralph Bunch High School. Additionally, Parker Gray alum Earl Lloyd was the first black to play in the NBA, and Leroy Keyes from Carver High School, Newport News, was second in the 1968 Heisman voting.
The 1965 Maggie Walker football team was special and had a player who may not have been as famous as his fellow alum, Tennis Hall of Famer Arthur Ashe, NFL Hall of Famer Willie Lanier, or two-time NBA champ Bob Dandridge. But this player has made a huge impact on thousands of people. You met him in part one. His name is Kermit Foster, president of Atlantic Coast Club. Let's examine the 1965 VIA football season through Maggie Walker High School lens. The Maggie Walker Green Dragons were coming off a successful 6-3 season, and head football coach Fred Cannonball Cooper was optimistic for the upcoming 1965 season.
During my high school days at Maggie Walker, I played for a coach named Cannonball Cooper. What I got from him was discipline. He did not allow us to miss practice. You know, I've never missed a day of practice. That's in high school or college. But discipline is the number one thing, and he was just a no-nonsense coach. He was a disciplinarian, and he's had a big impact on my life as well as many others.
The team returned several lettermen, including a potent backfield with Leroy Sledge, a 6'3", 205-pound bruiser, and Kermit Foster, a 5'7", 145-pound slasher.
It was a challenge for me because I was a small athlete coming up.
On the day's first day of practice, 100 players turned out. Coach Cooper said, "They're in pretty good shape. They've been running all summer long." All players got timed in the mile, and Kermit ran the fastest mile in 5 minutes and 30 seconds. Maggie Walker's first game was away at the always tough Norcombe Greyhounds, who had beaten them the previous year. However, in Portsmouth, Walker won 19-7. The second game was at home against Phoenix, and Walker prevailed to improve their record to 2-0. Game 3 against Cardoza was a non-conference game in Washington, D.C., with Kermit scoring 3 touchdowns in a 38-0 victory. The next game was at home against their nemesis, Huntington. For the past few years, Huntington has managed to be the only team in the VIA competition to stop the Dragons in their championship bids. However, the Green Dragons improved to 4-0 by stumping Huntington 21-0. Maggie Walker's next four games were on the road, starting with a short trip to nearby Petersburg, where they defeated Peabody to improve to 5-0. Next, the Dragons went to Norfolk for a 33-0 rout over Booker T. Washington to improve to 6-0. Kermit scored twice, one a 71-yard punt return, and the other a 29-yard run. Even though the season still had 4 weeks left, Hall of Fame writer Kyle Jacobs said Maggie Walker was the team most likely to finish undefeated. However, Coach Cannonball spoke differently and even warned his team, "They're out to get us." For Game 7, the Green Dragons traveled to Powhatan and defeated St. Emma 46-0 to remain undefeated. Game 8 was another away game in Danville and another victory for Maggie Walker, this time against Langston 41-0 to improve their record to 8-0. After a month on the road, they returned home to play Carver of Newport News, who had defeated them the previous year, led by the previously mentioned Leroy Keys, who was now a freshman at Purdue. But it would be deja vu when Carver upset them 19-13. The winning score came on a controversial sleeper play that caused Walker to protest to the VIA that it had been beaten illegally. However, the VIA ruled that the play was legal, and now they were 8-1 with one game left against crosstown rival Armstrong. The Armstrong-Walker Classic was always the last game of the season played on Thanksgiving weekend at the Richmond City Stadium, and always in front of big crowds. Maggie Walker won 18-0 in front of a whopping 24,000 spectators to finish the season at 9-1. However, since there was not any playoff system, the million-dollar question was, did Walker win the VIA state championship? That question remained a mystery until December the 4th, when the VIA executive board met at Virginia State University to decide what team deserves the crown. The VIA used the unpredictable Dickerson rating system, which was complicated and confusing, using a weighted point system with more points for wins over teams in the VIA first division. Maggie Walker was 8-1 in league games, but two other schools were 6-0 and another team was 7-1. 2 years earlier, Maggie Walker was in the same scenario and finished second, so the expectations were not very high. After waiting 1 week, it was announced that Maggie Walker was the 1965 VIA state football champions, and the Green Dragons were bringing home the bacon. Here are the final standings, with Walker leading with a rating of 25.63. There was a three-way tie for second with 23.33 points, with Union Kempsville, Riverview, and Carver of Rapidan. Coach Cannonball said he was really surprised and added they had the same record in 1963 and did not win. Kermit had an outstanding year with over 1,000 yards in total offense and received several postseason awards. Kermit was the only player to make All Central District both ways, on offense at running back and on defense at safety.
I was always on the field.
On reflecting back on the 1965 championship season, Kermit said this:
"There was a good group of athletes and it was a good team."
Kermit received a football scholarship to Norfolk State University and later became the president of the Atlantic Coast Club, a position he still holds today. Part 5B of this 10-part film will examine both, but now let's finish our examination of the VIA.
VIA merger.
In 1956, Virginia passed a group of evasive laws known as the Massive Resistance to prevent integration of the public schools. Prince Edward County in Virginia closed its entire public school district for 5 years rather than integrate. In September 1958, Norfolk closed 3 high schools and 3 junior high schools rather than let 17 black students, aka the Norfolk 17, attend the 6 all-white schools. However, after a ton of opposition, along with a state and a federal ruling, the 6 schools reopened in 1959 on February the 2nd. Even though the most iconic photo from the Norfolk 17's first day of school is Lewis Cousins sitting in the Morrill High School auditorium, most of the national spotlight was on Norview High School, since it had the majority of the students with 7, and coupled with the 5 at nearby Norview Junior High, the 2 Norview schools accounted for 12 of the 17 students. Here are three of the black students entering Norview High School, including Andy Heidelberg. And this is what he heard on his first day of school when he went to the auditorium to pick up his schedule.
Fee, fee, fi, fi, fo, fo, fum. I smell a nigga in the auditorium. Charlie Brown.
And it only got worse from there on that first day of school for Andy.
So when I got in the classroom, I said, well, I'm going to sit by the windows. That way, if they try to lynch me, I can jump out the window. You was thinking, how do I get out of here? I was so sure somebody, they were going to try to kill me. And there was no question about it. I sat down right on the second row on the end. The guy in front of me got up. The girl beside me got up. And the guy in the back of me got up. So I had my own space. And they told me, why do we have to have a nigga in our classroom? We don't want no niggas in our... I'm thinking the teacher's going to say, hey, hey, calm down. She just let it. I mean, it just went on until the bell rang the second time when you're supposed to be in your own room. She said, well, okay, class, calm down. And she started calling the roll. And, I mean, they were, like, shooting spit wads at me, throwing paper clips. And she never, ever, ever said a freaking word to anyone. That first day was so bad. You go to every class, and in every class, it was the same exact thing.
Now, listen to this. One day after PE class, Andy was taking a shower, and he couldn't understand why so many white guys kept walking by looking at him. He asked a white friend of his what was going on. His white friend told him, you're not going to believe this, but they think black people come from monkeys, and they were looking to see if you had a tail.
The Norview Palace football team was a powerhouse, having won 2 state titles in 4 years, along with having the state's longest winning streak. 250 students were trialed for the team this year, and their games averaged 10,000 fans. Andy got cut from the team both his sophomore and junior years. Andy was asked if he got cut because he was too light at 150 pounds. He said no, he got cut because he was too dark, which was true. However, team captain and All-American Ken Whitley told the coach that they would protect Andy, and he made the team his senior year, making Andy the first black to play varsity football at an all-white public school in the South. After his first game, Andy was called a star, and his Norview classmates were now singing a different tune. We want Andy, and he responded with an 81-yard kickoff return. Andy spent the previous 2 years playing in Norfolk's Black Recreation League, led by director Columbus Joe Austin, and credited his impressive debut to his recreation background. Joe Austin added that he was not surprised, and Andy was an inspiration to the other kids while also being a leader off the field. Norview won the Eastern District and Andy excelled. However, there were some problems, including opponents hitting him out of bounds, others trying to break his fingers, and some even bent him. Oscar Smith High School forfeited this game against Norview because it had a black player. In addition to Ken Whitley, Andy had another close friend on the team, Calvin Zongalowicz, who was also an outstanding running back.
I know Coach Whitley very well. He was my phys ed teacher when I attended Norview High School. However, I met Coach Whitley way before I got to high school. He had just started teaching there in the late 60s when my dad was a guidance counselor over there. Also, in the early 1970s, he was a lifeguard at Camp Young. We called him Hercules. Camp Young was owned by Norfolk Public Schools. Anyone that went to Camp Young in the early 1970s, they knew Hercules, and they knew he was a good man. That's why I'm not surprised by the way he treated Andy Heidelberg.
At the end of the season, Hall of Fame writer Kyle Jacob saluted Andy and concluded by saying Andy has every right to be proud of the contribution he made to the March of Progress in sportsdom in 1961. Lastly, legend Jim Brown commended him for his courage, and Andy received a football scholarship to Virginia State College Norfolk Division, today's Norfolk State University. In 1964, basketball players Nelson Hudgens and Charles Hatcher excelled for Norview High, and Hatcher also ran track. However, school integration was still moving slowly, and sporting events were moving quietly, with a black student athlete here and a black student athlete there. But that would soon change with the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which would also mean the beginning of the end for the BIA.
In 1965, BIA Chairman C.D. Page resigned, and Charles Thurston was selected to be the new chairman. By 1967, most Virginia school districts were integrated, which meant 38 black high schools closed or were converted into junior high schools. This 1967 state basketball tournament program included an article written by Charles Womble stating that the VIA will continue to serve as long as the need demands.
However, the need for the VIA was dwindling, and Womble also said in that same article,
"When the justification for its existence disappears, its epitaph should read, 'Here lies the VIA, champions of Virginia's youth needs to the end.'"
And the end was coming soon, since all Virginia schools had to be integrated by the 1969-70 school year, and federal funding would no longer support two activity programs. And that was when
the VIA first approached the VHSL to merge, and the two organizations formed a merger committee, but little progress was made during the first year of negotiating.
However, that changed with a 1968 federal ruling in the state of Alabama that ordered the merger of Negro and White Athletic Associations and an immediate end to segregated high school athletics in Alabama. The court also gave them 30 days to complete the merger. That ruling, along with the upcoming federal deadline, intensified the merger talks in Virginia. On October 2, 1968, the committee met with three representatives from the VIA and four reps from the VHSL. The newspaper summarized the meeting with this headline: VIA schools are invited to join the VHSL. This was because no agreement was reached, but the VHSL said it was open for applications from VIA schools.
But the VIA wanted to merge as a group, not individual schools, and the merger talks again stalled.
On December the 10th, 1968, the VIA Executive Committee met, and Chairman Thurston introduced a special guest, Dr. Nathan Johnson, who represents the Consultative Center at the University of Virginia, along with being the Associate Director for School Desegregation Problems. Dr. Johnson was also present at the last meeting between the two organizations.
He knew most of the VIA representative because he was a former educator in their system.
Johnson was here to bridge the gap, and he began his remarks by expressing appreciation for the opportunity to meet with some of his former VIA colleagues to give his impression of his meeting with the VHSL Executive Committee. He said the impression was not good, and here is why.
The VHSL has adopted a waiting game, as evidenced in three ways.
First, the announcement of acceptance of individual applications from VIA schools for VHSL membership. Next, the 1969 phasing out of the Negro schools. And last, they are disturbed by finding out that former VIA schools are now dissatisfied in the VHSL.
There were now over 20 VIA schools in the VHSL, most of them due to court rulings.
Dr. Johnson then told the VIA their strong points, or as he put it, cards to play. First, growing dissatisfaction of former VIA schools with VHSL membership, and also this discontent can grow to major proportions. In closing, he emphasized the main reason it is hard to sell the VHSL on merger is because there is a lack of adequate communication and understanding. Also, Dr. Johnson reiterated his willingness to assist in the talks. And finally, in a brief question and answer period, he made these additional suggestions. The naming of some men as Negro leaders has no great significance, and instead insist on having some Negro leaders in a statewide organization. Also, something should happen to Mr. Womble, the VIA Executive Secretary, from day one. Dr. Johnson also said, demand that the VHSL have a plan, and a formal proposal should be sent to the VHSL. The VIA Executive Committee heeded his advice, and 8 days later, on December the 18th, 1968, they sent a two-page letter to the VHSL Legislative Council in care of Chairman Ralph Kier.
I'll summarize this epic letter in three parts:
background, appeal, and proposal. First, background. The VIA pointed out that they initiated the talks 2 years ago to a merger to ensure that the students of the VIA schools would have the opportunity to continue to participate in school activities.
Additionally, they noted that their days were numbered.
As evidenced by the loss of 53 VIA schools in recent years, 38 of them to the Civil Rights Act of 1964.
Moreover, the 1969-70 deadline set to unify the remaining segregated school divisions was near, and the need for the VIA would no longer exist. But it would be a tragedy if no positive action is taken to revive one organization immediately. The VIA added these three opinions from the joint talks. First, the impression that the VHSL is opposed to one state activity organization. Second, asking each VIA school to join individually in this manner is unsatisfactory. And third, they said that the VHSL delaying tactic showed a lack of good faith. The VIA then appealed to the VHSL because they were the dominant activity organization in Virginia, powerful and affluent because of its close association and connection with the University of Virginia, the educational leader in Virginia, an equal employment institution which made it the recipient of vast federal funds, and the VHSL has a responsibility for exercising leadership and bringing about unity in the school activity programs of Virginia. Since the time is right for one statewide organization for school activities, the VIA asked the VHSL to agree now to work with them, including these two considerations. The first was a guarantee of full participation by all member schools to include a schedule of activities to qualify for district, regional, and state honors. And the second was inclusion of the VIA Executive Secretary Charles Womble and his staff to the VHSL Central Administration Office. In closing, the merger committee have agreed to continue their joint discussions, but unless the main purpose is to establish one high school activity organization, the discussions are really of no great significance.
In other words, the VIA was saying, let's talk to merge or not talk at all.
The letter ended with the hope of a favorable early reply.
The VHSL responded by sending the VIA a counter proposal, which included a provision that all VIA schools would have full VHSL membership rights. And on March the 8th, 1969, the VIA approved the VHSL merger proposal. And it was announced that the VHSL and VIA were merged with an effective date of July the 1st, 1969.
At 7 p.m. on June the 17th, 1969, at the Magnolia Room of the Golden Triangle Motel in Norfolk, the final meeting of the Virginia Interscholastic Association was held. 40 member principals, several invited guests, and many former VIA principals attended. Following dinner, Chairman Charles Thurston called a meeting in order at 7:45 before Executive Chairman Charles Womble presided. In his remarks, Womble stated that he was happy that they had come to share in the fellowship and nostalgia occasioned by the imminent passing of the VIA. Also, the merger with the VHSL was summarized along with the VIA reconciliation plan. The three VIA representatives who were now on the VHSL Policy Committee gave remarks which indicated that the VHSL members were sincere and acting in good faith. General remarks were made by many which reflected fond memories of the VIA and approval of 15 years of service. Lastly, many felt that they had no choice but to merge with the VHSL, and on that note, the chairman adjourned the meeting at 9:15 p.m. along with the VIA's existence.
Out of the 115 VIA high schools, only three still exist today as a regular high school. Maggie Walker is currently a governor school, and only 8% of its students are black. The three regular high schools are Armstrong of Richmond, IC Norcom of Portsmouth, and Booker T. Washington of Norfolk. Part 5B of Real Deal Track Journey featuring Atlantic Coast will be released later this spring with the years 1994 through 1999 of the Track Journey.